Hi, I'm Abhi Banerjee from the Kundaje Lab at Stanford University. I'd like to thank the organizers of the Regs Discourse for giving me this opportunity to talk about deep learning alternative binding motifs of C2H zinc finger transcription factors. So the C2H2 family of zinc finger transcription factors is basically the largest family of transcription factors in humans. It's about half of all the human TFs, and there's around 800 of them. But the thing is that the DNA binding preferences for many of these transcription factors is not very, very well known. So this is how a canonical C2H2 zinc finger transcription factor looks like. So there's these DNA binding zinc fingers, which recognize DNA, and you can have a bunch of zinc fingers inside each of these TFs. So you can have as many as 39 of these zinc finger domains, which would mean that you can recognize really long sequences. Now, this is how a zinc finger domain looks like. So there's this alpha helix, which coordinates with the zinc atom, and there's specific locations on this alpha helix at these minus 1, 2, 3, 6, where the residues actually determine the specificity to the trinucleotide of DNA that it binds. And now this mapping of amino acid sequence of the zinc finger to the trinucleotide DNA sequence that is bound by it is referred to as the zinc finger recognition code. And a lot of work has been done in determining what the zinc finger recognition code is. And so how this was done is that the bacterial 1 hybrid assays were modified, and the EGR1 zinc finger TF was modified in a way that the last zinc finger is modified. And this way, the preferences of different zinc finger domains were learned. Now you can concatenate predictions that were learned by this B1H method, and you can make a prediction for a list of zinc finger domains by concatenating these predictions, and you can have a predicted motif for every zinc finger transcription factor. And this is what is referred to as the B1H recognition code. So there have also been in vitro studies on zinc finger transcription factors, such as HT-Selects, PBM, and SmileSeq. But the thing about in vitro studies is that we do not know how well this would translate to in vivo in the presence of chromatin. And also, like, it's not clear if in vitro and in vivo binding would use the same sets of zinc fingers, right? So to understand in vivo binding, you'd need to do ChIP-seq. Now, it has been hard to do ChIP-seq for these family of TFs because it's hard to find antibodies that would target these zinc finger transcription factors. So to get around this, there have been a few previous large-scale studies from the Hughes lab and the Trono lab where they actually created TF fusions with the GFP, and which they expressed in HEC293 cells, and then the chip for the GFP. And they've done this for many hundred zinc finger TFs. And we created this expanded set of C2H2 zinc finger transcription factors by also doing ChIP-seq on 208 C2H2 zinc fingers as part of ENCODE. And now putting everything together, the ENCODE data set and the previous data sets, we have 422 TF for which we have ChIP-seq. So all of this ENCODE data has been processed by ENCODE's processing pipelines and can be found on the ENCODE project website. And so once you have ChIP-seq and ChIP-exo data, you want to do motif discovery. So some of the previous motif discovery for C2H2 zinc finger transcription factors is focused on actually using the recognition code to guide motif discovery. And this works pretty well in practice, but there's an issue with all the motifs that are out there for zinc finger transcription factors. The issue is that the motifs are much shorter than what you would expect. So the motifs you would expect would be like three times the number of zinc fingers long, where this is the number of zinc finger domains in the TF. But the reason for this is that each zinc finger binds three nucleotides of DNA. But as you can see, the motifs are much shorter than what you would expect. So what would be the reason for this? Like, why are the motifs shorter than you would expect on the basis of maybe the zinc finger recognition code? So to try and understand this, we can study the best, we can look at the best studied C2H2 zinc finger transcription factor, which is CTCF. Now, CTCF binds this canonical motif, and this is actually bound using the zinc finger domains 4 to 7 of CTCF. And generally, this is found on like several tens of thousands of sites across the genome. But it turns out that there's a upstream motif which is bound by a smaller subset of fingers. And this upstream motif is found on a very small set of sites, like only 3,000 sites. And it's bound by this set of fingers 9 to 11. Now, could it be that this upstream motif is what is getting missed out in all these other C2H2 zinc finger transcription factors? To summarize the questions we have in mind, it's like, why are the C2H2 zinc finger motifs so short? And are there multiple binding modes where, you know, there are alternate motifs which are bound by alternate sets of zinc finger domains? So to try and understand these questions better, we train neural network models. And these models are trained to predict ChIP-seq and ChIP-exo binding profiles from DNA sequence. And after training these models, we turn to interpret these models using a backpropagation-based interpretation tool developed in our lab called DeepLift. And this propagates scores back to the sequence, so you learn important regions learned by the model to be predictive of DNA binding. And some of these results are actually shown here, like for ZNF-140. We see that we can actually predict the profiles pretty well. and the blue is the positive strand profile, and the yellow and the orange is the negative strand profile. And more importantly, you see that deep lift actually highlights the sequence that has been learned to be very important for DNA binding for DNF140. And so after you have important scores, you can actually cluster regions of high importance scores together to learn DNA binding motifs. And we call this method as TF Modisco, and it's been developed in our lab. So we applied this TF Modisco method for motif discovery to the zinc finger transcription factors. And what I've shown here is comparisons to gold standard motifs from HT-Selects. And you see that we do really favorably compared to the HT-Selects motifs. We also compared to previous in vivo motif discovery methods such as Arcade, and we generally find that we can recover the Arcade motif with at least one of our zinc finger, with at least one of our motifs. So we then try to understand, like, okay, so what can we do beyond these previous methods? And we came to understand that it's actually very important to align the motif we learn to the recognition code. Now, why is this important? Now, this is important because if you can get the alignment working, you'd actually know which part of the motif aligns to the recognition code. And this would tell you which zinc fingers are used to bind DNA in vivo. And you'd also learn the presence of gaps that are needed, which would tell you something about the flexibility of the zinc fingers moving around in binding. And we developed this tool using dynamic programming to allow for gapped alignments of our zinc finger motifs to the recognition code. So after we performed the gapped alignment, what did we learn? So we learned that there are many zinc finger transcription factors which actually have alternate motifs which bind to different parts of the recognition code. Now, this would mean like there are different zinc finger domains which are in action at different sites of the genome. So let's go into a few case studies in more depth. So the first one we look at in a lot of depth actually is ZNF140. So ZNF140, we found to have two binding modes. So the first binding mode, which we call the compressed motif, you can see it's compressed with respect to the recognition code, which is on top. It was also found by methods like HT-Selects and Arcade. But what we found is a novel motif, which is what we call the regular motif because it's not compressed. And this was actually found in only 10% of the binding sites. And so we want to validate this extended motif as well as the compressed motif. So we turned to this assay known as SpecSeq. And this SpecSeq is basically an in vitro assay by which you can measure the energetics of DNA binding with very high precision to like 0.1 KT resolution. And this SpecSeq assay was done by the Polyfortis lab, and Zhang was the postdoc who helped us do this. And so how this works is you have this library of DNA sequences you want to test, and you put it in gel with your TF of interest, and you basically sequence the part that is bound. And we actually learned the presence of both the binding modes, and these are the energy logos that we learned. And using the energy logos that you learned for binding, you can actually score every sequence in your library. And if you use the compressed motif energy model that we learned and score every sequence, you would see that there's this blob in blue, which is actually much lower in energy than predicted by the compressed motif model. So what does this mean? So this means that this blue blob actually has sequences which are more stable than you would expect. And this blue blob actually corresponds to instances of what make up the regular length motif. So what does this mean? This means that there are these sequences which correspond to the regular length motif, and they're energetically more stable than you would predict using the compressed motif model. And similarly, we see that if you use the extended motif model to score all the sequences, you're not able to explain the energetic stability of the set of sequences which make up the compressed motif model. So this means that ZNF140 actually has two distinct binding modes, and you need both the energy-based models to fairly explain the stability of all the sequences. So we then see that if you actually score every sequence with the minimum energy from both the energy models, you get this beautiful straight line. So we see that both models taken together is a fairer representation of the energetics of the binding of ZNF140. So here's another example. So what we did was we did this kind of thing where we train this model and we interpret and learn motifs for every zinc finger TF that we have in our database. And so we then made this motif resource for every zinc finger TF that we have, right? And so I'm showing you like one more example. Like this is ZNF382. And so this is the primary motif of ZNF382 aligned to the recognition code. We see that we use all the zinc fingers in this motif. Then we find a secondary motif, which actually uses just this part of the recognition code and does not even seem to be using this part. Then we find a third motif, which seems to be using even fewer zinc fingers, like just this beginning part here. And we find a fourth motif, which uses just the central part. So ZNF382 can basically bind combinatorially with different sets of zinc fingers. And so this is what our motif resource would look like for zinc finger transcription factors. And we're going to create a website and host all of these things. And so to summarize some of these things, basically, like, what does this mean? So what I've plotted here on the y-axis is the number of zinc finger domains that have been mapped to bind DNA in at least one of our motifs per transcription factor. And on the x-axis, you have the number of zinc finger domains, right? So if you look at the plot above, this is the set of motifs on CISPP, the motifs that are out there. And what you see is like what I mentioned before, that the motifs basically out there, they do not seem to be using all of the zinc fingers that they have. And there isn't a very good correlation with increasing motif length, with increasing number of zinc fingers and the number of zinc fingers actually found to bind DNA. But using our set of improved motifs, we find that the number of zinc finger domains that are found to engage in binding DNA improves a lot. And we start seeing this this linear trend that starts to emerge. And so like the number of zinc finger domains now actually seems to be quite indicative of the number of zinc fingers domains that are used to bind DNA in at least one motif. And we can make a direct comparison now with the number of zinc finger domains we found to engage DNA versus that's out there by scouring the CISPP database. And we see that we really improve a lot. And we see that many more domains are used to bind DNA now than were previously reported to be binding DNA. And so to summarize these results, we found strong evidence for multiple binding modes using alternate sets of zinc fingers. And we find also strong evidence for the usage of additional zinc fingers beyond previously discovered. And so now I'm moving on to the next part of my talk, where we're going to talk about C2H2 zinc fingers and how they relate to endogenous retroelements. So a lot of prior work has actually documented in detail about how some of these C2H2 zinc fingers, the crab zinc fingers in particular, they have known to have co-evolved with different families of endogenous retroelements. Now this co-evolution actually happened because these crab zinc fingers, they evolved to silence some of these endogenous retroelements. And what happened after that was these endogenous retroelements then got into an arms race with these crab zinc fingers. And they started mutating to avoid getting bound by these crab zinc fingers, which were trying to silence them. And this led to like arms race dynamics between them. So what that means is like many of these retroelements, they started developing mutations and deletions, which would prevent them from getting bound by these crab zinc fingers. And some of the best known examples are like these retroelements L1PA1 and L1PA2, which are like the youngest line elements, about how they mutated and avoided getting bound by ZNF93 and ZNF765. And so this is actually shown here. This is taken from Trono's paper, and I'm showing this. Like, so these are the young line elements, L1HS and L1PA2. And what you see is that they actually developed deletions inside them, which prevented them from getting bound by ZNF93. And this happens exactly where the motif of ZNF93 is. And ZNF765 here, what you see is that as you go from older to younger line elements, like from bottom to top, you start seeing that mutations start accumulating right within the binding motif of ZNF765. And this is what prevents ZNF765 from binding these line elements, the younger line elements. So the question is, like, can we identify more such examples, right, of arms race dynamics? So how do we do this? So the thing is, we want to find more examples of arms race dynamics in some of these older line elements, right? So the issue with that is that these older line elements are more mutated, and so it's hard to do any kind of analysis on them. And also, like, the motifs of the zinc finger transcription factors have not been very good. And so maybe our new motifs could help us with this kind of analysis. So as part of a collaboration with the Hughes lab, we got access to full-length reconstructions of many of these older L1 elements, which they actually did, and it was very painstaking. So they made full-length ancestral reconstructions of many of these old L1 elements. So once we have these ancestor sequence of some of these L1 elements, we can actually use our set of zinc finger motifs and try to map where these things bind, right? So I'm going to show you one of these examples for L1MC1, which is like a pretty old L1 mammal-specific L1 line element. And it's known to be bound by these zinc finger transcription factors on the basis of like ChIP-seq. And now at a base pair resolution, I can pinpoint like where exactly these zinc finger transcription factors would bind this 6,000 nucleotide long L1 element. Because what you can see is that, like, I've highlighted ZFP69 here. You can see that exactly at this location between 4663 to 4713, we have our motif, and it exactly recognizes this sequence with very high specificity. And so we now know that ZFP69 would bind the ancestral sequence of the L1MC1, and it would exactly do it at this location, because you have an excellent match between the motif we learned and the ancestral sequence of this L1. And so I can show you like the other transcription factors as well, which were found to bind these L1 elements. So this is ZNF248, for example. You see that exactly at this region, this is the part of the L1 sequence that exactly matches the motif. So what we're not now, what we're trying to do is like we're trying to look at these ancestral L1 elements, and by looking at the sequence of L1 elements, we're trying to see like are there loss or gain of mutations which prevent them from basically getting bound by these zinc finger transcription factors, and which would give you examples of arms race dynamics. And this is basically work in progress, and we're trying to find more such examples. So to summarize what we've been doing, like we basically learned models of base resolution models of zinc finger transcription factors with ChIP-seq, ChIP-exo, and interpreting these models gives us transcription factor motifs, and we find strong evidence for multiple binding modes with alternate use of zinc fingers. And these improved models of these zinc finger motifs are helping us to uncover evolutionary dynamics of the crab ZFs with endogenous retro elements. And I'd like to thank all the people who have gone into making this project work. It's been a lot of work. And I'd also like to thank all my funding sources. And with this, I'd like to take questions. Thank you.